Good morning. I've been praying for you because I was going to come this Sunday and share, so this can be a great time. The thing I'm puzzled about is that big round thing on the back wall. Is that, did they put that up because I was coming? That clock? I'm not sure what that's about. So enjoy our visit today. This will be our last. Oh, that's funny. We don't want to stifle the Holy Spirit now, do we? You know, in the times that we live, our hearts are so broken for the broken people in our world. And even here this morning as we sit together, there's brokenness in this room. There are lives that are bruised, hearts that are broken. There's bondage here. Some people are captive by the pulls of carnality. And the Lord really led me this morning to begin with really taking care of that need. And so if you're here this morning, and you fit any one of those categories, if you're really struggling right now, if your heart's bruised or broken, if you're faced with a tragic situation or you're in the midst of that, would you stand up right now? Be bold. Thank you. Just be bold. We want to pray for you this morning. That smoking hot pastor's wife isn't supposed to be standing. And she's married to me. That's why she's standing. Anyone else? No, really, take the moment. This is the wisest thing we will ever do, is to be together and to lay hands on the people in our lives, to be the hearts of the Lord, to touch people in our lives with the hands of God that He uses in us, through us. And we want to pray. I'm going to pray for you all, but I just sort of desire to pray for those folks that are standing right now. And if stand up. If you've just got something going on, you know, weakness going on, if your heart's broken, if you're uncertain of your future, any of those things, just let your heart be softened. The Bible says, humble yourself in the sight of the Lord and He will lift you up. I want to give you a lift this morning before we begin. So would you do that? If you're close to somebody who's standing, would you lay your hands upon them this morning? And again, if you need prayer this morning, just stand up and let somebody come alongside. Lord, You've told us that we can come boldly to Your throne of grace to receive help in our time of need, to receive the grace that You continually and lovingly measure out in our lives every day. Lord, You know exactly what's going on in every life here, in every heart in this room, the ones that have raised to their feet, that are standing in humility in Your presence, Lord, in humility and yet very wise to do. Because, Lord, that is a proclamation, and You love that. Because You want to touch these hearts this morning. Lord, would You be with every one of these precious sons and daughters of Yours? You know the issue in their life. You know the struggle. You know the situation. You know the heartaches and the heartbreaks. You know the bruises. Some may be imprisoned by something. Some are chained to a power, Lord, in their flesh. We pray that You break the chains this morning. We pray that You tend the bruises with Your loving hand of grace and mercy and love. That You, Lord, would open the prison doors and set the captives free. That You, our Christ, our God, would do exactly what those hearts are needing right now. Fill them, bless them, and Lord, that we all in this moment as a family, as the family of God, that we would take this moment, Lord, to give you our undivided attention. I pray that everybody in this room would lay those silly thoughts aside that they were thinking a minute ago, that have nothing to do with you, maybe something with busyness, something with whatever, it doesn't matter what it is, Lord, that we would solely lay our lives on the altar of sacrifice right now as living sacrifices, so that you can lay your powerful, authoritative, loving, gracious, and merciful hands upon us. We just praise you, Lord, and we thank you. Receive from all of us, Lord, our hearts overflowing with thankfulness for meeting us here this morning. We so experience your presence right now and desire it in an enormous way. In the name of Jesus, we all pray. Amen. Amen. I don't know if I can get away from not sharing this techie moment that I've always, you know, I'm from Eastern Oregon. We're basically in the mission field in Eastern Oregon. Zane's there with Summer and the kids this morning. That's got to be a totally trippy deal for them. There's probably more people in that family than there are in the church this morning. And so, you know, it's kind of a neat thing. But Zane and I, your pastor and myself, we hooked up at the conference in Corvallis this past summer, and there was really something happening there in our relationship, and so we're just really enjoying a sweet fellowship as pastors, and just praying over our churches and our families, and just enjoying that. But I wanted you to experience Eastern Oregon technology. This is an Eastern Oregon iPad. And I didn't think it was fair that I move on without giving you kind of an update, because people will probably be swarming to Grant County now to kind of get in on the high-tech world that we live in. And so, you know, a pickup, a gun in the back, three dogs, and an iPad, and you are pretty much ready. You're set for life in the East, in the outback of Grant County, way more cattle than people. And, of course, you hunters know the region well, because you all throng to the place to try and take down the big bull elk that we all enjoy in our yards over there. So for you deer hunters, just a moment here. We'll be doing church on Sunday morning, and there'll be about five big bucks walking down the street in front of the church. In town, that's an in-town deal. I want to talk about something this morning that really is the deal. It's the whole deal, and nothing but the deal, so help all of us, in the name of Jesus. Some of you folks that are a little bit more advanced in years, such as myself, will know, as I share with you, and I'm going to put a spin on this, you see, what the world needs now. Remember Jackie DeShannon, what she sang in the day? What is it? It's love, sweet love, but I've changed it. What the world needs now is love, God's love. It's God's love, because we can come up with our version of love, and it's so incredibly short. It's so disastrous, isn't it? Just ask my wife. Although she wouldn't tell you the truth, because you see, that love that she has for the Lord and for me covers all of those failures. She is a smoking hot wife, spiritually in every way possible. And see, that's how we look at things as we look through the world's view. You might as well put some duct tape on that clock. I'm probably not going to look at it anyway today. I want to welcome those also that are watching in this morning over the internet. This aspect of love, I want to take you, if you have your Bibles, would you open them this morning to Deuteronomy, the fifth book in your Bibles, and chapter 6. Deuteronomy chapter 6. John 3:16, as we know, says, "For God so what? Loved the world," say it with me, "that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe in him would not perish, but have everlasting life." That's how much God loved the world. Imagine that, the world, the Jeffrey Dahmers, the Charles Mansons, ISIS. See, we've got to get to the place where we become what Christ has given us the ability to do. We need to arrive in the place that God commanded his chosen people. They were called the apple of his eye, very special thing to be called. And he loves them and he still does, and one day that's going to end up in a glorious way. He gave his only begotten Son, that whoever, anybody that would believe in him in the cosmos, across the planet forever and ever, that they would have everlasting life in heaven with the Lord, an abundant life blessed now. That's the love that can change the world right there. I want to read our text. You see, in the second giving of the law, which was being given by Moses to the generation that was moving in to possess the promised land, and remember what it was, at the land that what flows with? Milk and honey, all right? That's simply, milk and honey are symbolic of awesomeness, awesome blessing. That's what that is, milk and honey. But I want to give you the parallel because, you see, he didn't give us land per se. It wasn't a land. What was it? A new life. Not a land, but a life. And not necessarily milk and honey, but every spiritual blessing, the fruit of the Spirit, Galatians 5:22, those things that we will hopefully drop our anchor in a bit in this study. You see, we're floating on, we're cruising the love boat this morning. That's what we're doing. You know, don't start thinking about Captain Steuben and all those goofy characters. But the real love boat, the great ship Zion that we're on right now, unless you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ and you can't leave here today without surrendering to him. Because if you do, it's the silliest thing you'll ever do. Because you might be dead in this weather today after you leave. If you've been drugged here this morning, what a precious drug that is. Really? Yes. What? Or you could say, man, my wife may become one to drag. How? Thank her, would you? Thank her when you get home or when you're fighting in the car after the service. Whatever the thing is, you've got to just thank the person that's been praying for you, that's been dragging you to these things and to experience weirdness like me. Let's read our text today. You see, he was giving the second giving of the law. He gave them the Ten Commandments in chapter 5. And I want to pick up in chapter 5, verse 32. "Therefore, you shall be careful," Moses says to the children of God, "to do as the Lord God has commanded you. You shall not turn aside to the right hand or to the left. You shall walk in all the ways which the Lord your God has commanded you." This is why. It's not just, here's some rules, bang, bang, bang. And don't get that lemon look now. Don't have a long face because I've thrown some rules at you. He says, here's the deal. I want to what? I want to bless your life, that you may live and that it may be well with you. Do you know that all the Lord has done in all of our lives has always been to prosper us, to bless us, to guide us and direct us and even correct us, even though we don't like the corrections when they happen always. But we do come to the understanding that when we do embrace them, we know that now our faith is not only being tested, but we're growing in the grace and the knowledge of the Lord. We're becoming who God wants us to be in that. "Your days will be prolonged in the land which you shall possess," or for our case, in our life, our new born again life filled with the Holy Spirit and blessing and opportunity and all and prosperity spiritually. Now this, verse 1, is the commandment, and these are the statutes, the judgments, which the Lord your God has commanded to teach you, that you may, this is key, observe them in the land which you are crossing over to possess. For us, it's simple. I've given you a love letter that covers every basis in life, every station of life, so that you'll know how to deal with your marriage, your kids, the boss, your employees, so you can be the good neighbor, so you can be the person that God wants you to be in every aspect. That's what's going on here. He's given it, and if you'll do it, I want you to do it, he says. And for them, it was a command. Well, it's the law. Now, gang, you know, right? The law kills. The law, why? Because when you don't do it, it just kills you. But here's the glorious thing. We're saved by grace through faith. And that is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. We get to do this stuff. You've heard that 1,000 times. I'm going to say 1,000 more. We get to do this. We get to love the Lord. We get to have Christ in a personal relationship. We get to be these bizarre people. The Bible says we're peculiar. I look out here and I go, amen. Seriously, you Douglas Countyans. Why is there moss on everything here? That's freaking me out. There's got to be something good to that. There's got to be some medicine in there somewhere. I'm tripping. And I'm an old dude. Still tripping. I'm loving it here. This is becoming our home. Oh, we're still in John Day on the weekends, way out in the east doing ministry there, but we live in Glide. That's convenient. It's only a 640-mile trip to church and back. How glorious. God had to bring me here. I had to listen to the Lord to come here to make life more difficult for me so I could get back what I was losing. Which was a passion for God's people. Was the intimacy that I had with the Lord. Just being buried in life and busyness and working full time in a small town to be able to do ministry, and all was just the weight, and that just started slipping away. It started kind of squishing me out of the program, and I really didn't know why the Lord put it on my heart to seek a replacement and to come here. And then Zane shared with me one morning, early in the morning, he said, you know, God doesn't always make things easier for people in ministry to get them where he wants them to be. If you and if I will listen to the Lord, the word of God, his instructions in every aspect of life, and just do them. What does James 1:22 say? Be doers of the word, not hearers only. Deceiving yourself. If you hear this message this morning and the Lord's speaking to you and you don't act on it, you are deceiving yourself. The devil doesn't even have to show up in your life. You have done his bidding in your own life for him. So powerful that we think on this, that you may cross over into possess this land, that you may fear the Lord your God and keep all his statutes and his commandments, which I command you. Watch, 3 generations, you, your sons, your grandson. How long? For a month, 2, 6 months, couple years? All the days of your life, your whole life until you're not here anymore, until you're in the presence of the Lord. That's what he desires for us. And that your days may be prolonged. Therefore, hear, O Israel, and be careful to observe it, these laws, this main law we're talking about today, that it may be well with you. Again, he just desires us to be blessed, to do well, and that you may multiply greatly as the Lord God of your fathers has promised you, a land, here it is, flowing with milk and honey, awesomeness and blessing. So he says, hear, Shema. The word Shema in the Hebrew is the word that means to listen with intelligence. Not intellectually, but listen intelligently. To absolutely, totally tune in to what God is saying. And so he says to his people, listen to what I'm saying. It's kind of like he was grabbing the Jews' face collectively and just putting it right there. Listen to what I'm telling you, because this is the benchmark. This is the benchmark right here. Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God, key verse, with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your strength. And these words which I command you today shall be in your heart. Oh, we've got to get the Word of God into our heart. Gang, if you're not getting in the Word's not getting in your heart. You sow the Word into the tables of your heart, even though you don't remember it all, and it will come out. The Lord will bring it forth when it's needed. But here's the cool thing. Psalm 119 says, Thy word have I hid in my heart that I would not sin against you, O God. That's why I love just sitting for as much time as I can conjure up and just reading God's word. Because the more of it I put in, the less I sin. And I need to sin less. Pastor Ira needs to sin less. Oh, to clarify the who and the what, I'm just, who's that guy? And his wife. See, in humility, it's not important who we are. It's only important who we know. And that's the Christ, the King, the God that holds the universe in his hands. Love, you shall. For them, legally, you're gonna. What about for us, graciously? We get to. Have you thought about that lately? That God condescended to this earth to step alongside you, to step alongside me. If you knew where I'd been, you wouldn't want me up here. For maybe you people that need that connection, I lived all that. I lived in the sewer in this life. I've been delivered from immoral lifestyles, drugs, alcohol, all of it. I'm a piece of work. I lived there for decades. And yet, as Jesus proclaimed that day, those that are forgiven much love much. I'm the love bug, man. I don't even know you people, and some of you are probably really bizarre. And yet I can just, man, I can love you. I get to love God and I get to love you. Man, how cool is that? Because the world's starving for the right kind of thing, the right kind of love this world doesn't have. You shall do this. We get to do this. What an amazing opportunity that we, as Psalm 40 says, were in the horrible pit. He's pulled us out of the miry clay, set us upon a rock, and he has washed us in his blood. He has put a new song in our heart. How great is that? And it's not in a God of Davida or Stairway to Heaven. Although I can run with that, but we don't. We don't need to, because it happened in the Garden of Eden, which is kind of the play on that way back in the 60s, where they fell, where they failed. And here we are on our journey back to fellowship with God the Father through the blood of the Son, Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God that was slain for the sins of the world. We are climbing that stairway to heaven, if you will. Gang, have you thought about this later? We're on our way home right now. We're going home. Let go of this life. I've got to let go of this life. It is messing with me. Because I like too much stuff. I do. I've been blessed to go everywhere, do everything and all that, and yet I am at this place in my life now that it's like, who cares? It's so unimportant. A year and a half ago, everything that we had burned to the ground in the Eastern Oregon Canyon Creek Complex fire. 43 of us in the canyon south of John Day. A 3,000-degree firestorm came through and took everything that we knew to be our life and took it to the dirt. Things that connected us with three generations of family through the antiques and the pictures, a home that I'd spent 8 years, probably shouldn't have, but I did. I was just ready to finish it. About time to put a few pieces of trim on the outside in this beautiful rustic home built in the pine trees, where we had such solace, such peace. We had an outdoor amphitheater that we did church services in. Everything we have belongs to the Lord. And yet the Lord saw fit to let that go, to remove that from our life. We didn't doubt his love in that, nor did our love for him wane in that moment. But we have been desiring to know exactly what God has got planned, and what we're doing here, I know, has a little clue of that. These words will I command you today, they shall be in your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children, and shall take of them or talk of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes. The Jews back in the day had little boxes they'd strap to their wrist, or the one I love the most is frontlets. How'd you like to have a box right there? But what are you always thinking about? Man, that dang box! No, it was what was in the box. It's the Word of God. I think we need to market glasses where you can actually have little scriptural scrolls that roll up and down. You know, just punch the side, for God so loved the world. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I'm going to fear no evil. Whatever you need for the day, the Lord knows. Market something like that. You shall bind them. You shall write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates. Everybody that enters into your life needs to see who you are, not just by the signs, not just by the posters. I love coming up to a house where it says, "As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." We've had those in our life. You know, this county's crazy. There is more Jesus being publicized in this county than any place on the planet. And I love it. Everywhere I go, it's like, there he is. Jesus saves. I know. I'm driving around delivering fuel all over the county. But it's so glorious. And those blue Jesus things, man, somebody showed up with like a trainload of those. They're everywhere. I love it. But here's the thing. If there's no love behind it, what's it worth? 1 Corinthians 13, right? You can be a philanthropist. You can throw down your life physically. You can have spiritual gifts and orations, abilities and orations and all that with the angels. And I mean, amazing, glorious things. But if none of those are a product of the love that you have for the Lord, it is noisy, it is obnoxious, and it is senseless. That's what it is. It's phony. It's not real. So it shall be when the Lord your God brings you into the land of which you swore to your fathers, to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Listen to this. Don't check out yet. To give you large and beautiful cities which you did not build. He's bringing you into the land for them, a life for us, and he's going to supply all of our needs according to his riches and glory. He's going to give us homes. He's going to fill them with things that we need. Not necessarily the stuff we want always, but delight thyself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Here's the trick to that, by the way. The more you love the Lord, the more you want the Lord, the more you ask for the things of the Lord, the more you get what you ask for, which is more of Jesus. Should we break into that? I want more of Jesus, more and more and more. Am I stuck in the kids' ministry? You know the anchor to that song, right? Some of you are looking at me like, dude, he is from the 60s. I want more of Jesus, more and more and more. I want more of Jesus than I've ever had before. Little song thing here. I want more of his great love, rich and full and free. And here's the deal. I want more of Jesus So I'll give him more of me. What a concept. Hopefully that was done in a way that you're all going, what? But you're going to remember that. You want more of the Lord, then give him more of you. Jesus said, draw close to me, I'll draw close to you. Come on. It's so simple. You want to experience the love of God, then love him. Love him for who he is. Love him for what he does, what he is doing. Oh, houses full of goods which you didn't fill, hewn out wells which you didn't dig, vineyards and olive trees which you did not plant when you had... Please, everybody, don't check out right here. Because he's just talked about America. And I love the Lord because he's so sharp. He says, now listen, once you've gotten there, Christian, once you have your new life and the weight of judgment is gone, you're free. You've got the love and the grace and the mercy happening. Things are going right. Things are getting better. God's blessing you. And you've got, all of a sudden, you've got a better job, and he's blessed you with a better car, a gooder place to live. Grant County Dictionary. Don't forget it. Don't forget him. Then be aware when you've received all these things that the Lord has blessed you with in this new life, lest you forget the Lord who brought you out of the land of Egypt. Egypt is a symbol of what? The world. He's brought you out of the world of sin and bondage, from the house of bondage. Uh-oh, gang, we close our verses for that text right there. Jesus would say this, and of course, you got to flip my iPad here. Hold it. It works. Although if you do it too hard, you rip the page. How much? All of your heart. How much of your soul? Do I have to do the all thing here? All means all, and that's all that all means. Okay, some of you have heard that way more than I've said it. All of the strength. Oh, that came from Mark's gospel, and in Matthew it says mind. You got the heart, soul, the mind, and the strength, every station of life, every part of you. Let me give you an example. Going into the promised land, Joshua 1:7 says, be strong and very courageous, that you may observe to do according to all the law which Moses, my servant, commanded you. Do not turn from it. So when the Lord speaks into your life through this study, through a Bible study, through a morning devotion, through a men's meeting, a woman's meeting, a conference, whatever, when he speaks to you and you know he's speaking to you, listen to him, hear what he's saying, and act on it. Do what he says. What a concept. It's escaping the 21st century church. Doing what the Lord tells us to do. We are blood-bought, precious family. Don't ever forget that he laid down his life to give us life. We are bought with the precious blood of the Lamb. Well, I love this. He says, be, and I love this. It takes strength. It takes courage to be a Christian today. We're the oddballs. We're the ones that hopefully don't want to live like the world does. So it takes strength. It takes courage to stand apart. So do that, so that you will do what I'm commanding you this day. Do not turn to the right hand or to the left, that you may prosper. Do what God tells you to do so that you can experience the prosperity in your life and every aspect, I believe, that he wants you to experience. Hearing God's word and then doing what he says is the key to prosperity spiritually. Don't misunderstand what I just said. I'm not a prosperity teacher unless we're talking about prospering in everything that God has planned for your life. It's not going to do us any good to stand up and hold our Bibles up and you know, say it like you mean it. What? What about just mean it? I can't stand that. What do you mean? Wait, what, pretend? And if you say the words, that's all good? Just say these words and then get the funnel out. God's going to bless you. No. And please don't misunderstand, I'm not throwing down on anybody, but I hear this insanity. I see these silly things going on the television around the world. They're an infestation to the truth and the power and the glory of God. Amen? And by the way, you don't have to agree with me on anything. I'm not here for that. Amen, I like that. Fill your heart with God's word. Here's the thoughts. I'm just recapping some thoughts. Pass it on to your kids. Be diligent. Teach them God's word. Keep your Bible. And I love this. Remember the frontlets and the on the wrists and then the frontlets here and the phylacteries and all that. Little boxes. This is my play on that. Check it out. I like this. Keep your Bible handy. By the hand, on the wrist, right? So that you can see clearly. Oh, but just don't carry it around, please. It's not a decoration. It needs to be the foundation of your life. You know how amazing it is that we can own Bibles? And have as many as we want and have different versions and read them and be filled by what's in them and reminded and pointed in the right direction and share those things with people, the riches of God, all these things. So crazy, so crazy. Don't forget all the blessings in your life, gang. Matthew 22 says this, in an attempt to trap Jesus in his words, a Pharisee who was a lawyer asked Jesus, well, what's the greatest commandment in the law? And Jesus replied, you shall love the Lord. I'm bringing it up to speed for us Christians. Not get out of the law, move up to Jesus now, the grace that has saved us. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. Mark again brings in 12:30 the strength as well. Now, we just have to go to Romans right here. I'll read it to you. Turn there if you want or not. Because we're talking about neighbors. All of this hinges. Jesus would say, all of this is going to hinge on loving your neighbor. Again, Matthew 22 was our text there and verse 34. I love this. 22:34-40, if you're writing down scriptures, if you're looking at those things in that way. 34, there we go. Jesus replied, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment, and second is like it. This is where we're going today. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Everything hangs on those two laws. Now, Romans in chapter 13 and verse 8 says, owe no one anything except to love one another. For he who loves another has fulfilled the law. This is Romans 13:8-14. For the commandment, you shall love, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness, you shall not covet. And if there is any other commandment, they're all summed up. Listen, every commandment of God, every desire God has for your life is summed up in loving God and loving people. And right here, Jesus hangs it on loving people. But here's the thing, you can't love people until you love God. You can't love them right. Our love is so full, it's like Swiss cheese. It's the wrong kind of holy. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. He says, there it is, man. It's summed up in this saying. Love doesn't, why? Here's an example. He says, love doesn't harm their neighbor. Oh, let's clarify. Who's your neighbor? Anybody but you. So some of your family members are neighbors. Who do we struggle with most? Sometimes. Our own family members. Be careful. Love does no harm to the neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfillment of the law. And do this knowing the time. Gang, listen, hear this morning. Do this. Love God. Love people. Knowing the time that now it is high time to awake out of sleep, for now our salvation is nearer than when we first believed. The night is far spent. The day is at hand. Therefore, let us cast off the works of darkness and let us put on the armor of light. Let us, here it is, walk properly as in the day, not in revelry and drunkenness, not in lewdness and lust, not in strife and envy, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to fulfill its lusts. Put on Jesus. Run a spear through the old man or gal if she starts to roar. It's bad enough the devil's seeking who he might devour like a roaring lion all the time, but you don't need to be your own problem. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ, the armor of God, Ephesians 6. You know it well. Gang, when we love people with God's love, it takes care of those stinking sins that can and will bite us if we don't love people. You know, right here. And by the way, those listed are all dealing with our relationships with other people. Adultery, sexual immorality of every kind. Murder, obviously not a good deal. Jesus says, I don't even want you to murder people in your heart. Not fair. Right? Who's busted here today? Can't be trusted. You know, when you look at the description of love and you know, you love the word, but you hate some of it. Love thinks no evil. Love doesn't have bad thoughts. Well, how did I get left out of that deal? I have bad thoughts. I got the Rocka thing going on way too much. What is that? Some of you do too. That's when that guy cuts you off and you go, hey, you idiot. Did you know that that's Rocka? Jesus said, bad Christian. You know, you can't go around calling people empty heads. Why? Because they're made in the image of God. Oh. And I've been out there for over 4 million miles in my trucking career since 1974. I have slaughtered the nation. Because, of course, I'm the most awesome, you know, driver in the planet, and everybody else is an idiot. God resists the proud. No stealing, it's not right. No coveting. Godliness with contentment is great gain. Don't be lying. Don't be stealing. Don't be lying. Don't be doing stuff that the world does. You know, Paul said in 2 Corinthians 5:14, the love of Christ compels us. It doesn't compel us to sin. It compels us not to sin. That's what I love about the Apostle Paul and all that. Dear, oh, precious family of God, don't worry, you'll get rid of me in a few minutes. But please hear what God wants you to hear this morning, because I've got nothing to do with this. I'm a vessel that I pray every day that God just opens the valve and lets all the garbage out, so that I can refill every day with the Spirit of God, so I can be used for the glory of God, by the power of God, in lives that need God. You know, back to the thought, you know, this place is so peppered with, I mean, the billboard thing on the freeway, it's like, yes! I'm not going to hell. I love those billboards. See, when I see those billboards, you're going to heaven or hell, I like the opposite. I'm going to heaven. That was a Hillsong worship moment. I look at that and I go, I'm not going to hell. How glorious is this? If you're born again, sealed by the Spirit, filled with the presence of God, and you're here this morning, you're not going to hell. Huh? Who can do that thing that really, or the guys, they go that woo thing. Can anybody do that here? Yeah, there you go. I've always wanted to do that, but I can't. Because there's so many occasions where you just want to give it that thing, you know? I'm so jealous when guys just go, you know, they just roll back and they just woo, you know, that big old thing. And I'm going, oh, yeah. I got some closing things here. Can you bear with me? Jesus has delivered us from the penalty of sin. He has set us free, opened the prison doors, broken the chains, tended our bruises, healed our broken hearts. He has given us a new life that He wants to bless abundantly if we will just love Him more than maybe we do this morning. More than anything else in this life. And then take that love and pay it forward. That's a phrase from today. Pay it forward, man. Get it on somebody. Be so filled with the love of God that you just grab a whole pile and go, phew. How do you like me now? And I mean, you just, but I mean, in a loving thing, whatever that means, whatever that looks like, it can be just coming alongside somebody in the simplest way. Helping somebody in the grocery store. Meeting the need of a single mom with kids that's cold in the winter. And on and on and on. And by the way, they're not random acts of kindness. They need to be plotted. They need to be planned. We need to go after the people that don't know Christ. In this world, evangelism needs to be happening. You know, I can't remember the author, and I've got it somewhere around here, but he said a church that dies is a church that refuses or stops evangelizing. That's a church that will die. A church that will die is a church where new converts don't become disciples, and then those disciples refuse to become apostles. From saved to following the Lord, to serving God. That's the plan that God has. We're not saved just to be sitting there. We're saved to serve. Gang, RCF family, plug into something. Sign up for something. And I love this phrase, just do something. Do something for Christ. He gave you His life. He has poured it out through His blood. He has given you opportunities. Man, I look at this presentation up here and I'm going, am I in Beverly Hills? Is this Hollywood? This is insanely cool. They've moved past the iPads from Eastern Oregon. Be used for the glory of the kingdom of God. And everything you do, do it all in the nature, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And do it for the glory of God. Do it in a way that people will know who you belong. What Jesus say? Man, if you're mine, follow me, stay in the word, I'll set you free. But here's the thing, people are going to know you're mine by what? The love that you have for one another. Love one another. It's the deal. It's the thing. Love Him more than anything in this life. And then take that love and pay it forward. Love, oh, love God. Love people. Love your enemies. Getting harder. Can I say it this way? We only have one enemy. His name's Lucifer. It's just so tragic that He's been able to use so many people. But Jesus Christ wants to set those people free. He wants to give them what He's given us. He wants to set the captives free. He wants to save ISIS. Can you imagine if ISIS just flipped around, got born again, what they could do with the same energy for the church globally? What an amazing thing. He loves those people. See, oh, check this out. Husbands, love your wives. We're not going there, are we? No, it's time. Time's up. I did one of the most dangerous things the other day any pastor could ever do. I asked my wife if she felt loved. Not did she hear that she's loved. And it was a sincere question. It scared me to death. It was a good answer. But you know why? Because I'm trying to. And I am coming to a close with these thoughts, which have to do with that and ties this all together. You've got a chance today. You young people, man, I love seeing young people here. It's funny, I look out and see the young people, and you know, you're the age of my grandchildren. I'm going, oh, am I still above the earth? Am I still on top of the dirt here? You have a chance to turn this world upside down by loving God more than anything you could possibly imagine. And then letting that love channel through you into the lives of other people. Love those crazy college students you're hanging out with or in high school or junior high. Reach out to the crazy kids. Reach out to the bummed kids. Reach out to the bullies. Reach out to those kids whose lives are probably so destitute for all the right things. Love your wives, guys. I'm in my mid-60s. And I realized losing a friend about 3 weeks ago here, having two grandchildren with the Lord already, listening to a song that my son-in-law wrote, we all live on borrowed time. We have no clue. Nobody in this room can tell us how long you're going to be here. I have an 8-year-old granddaughter with the Lord and a 15-year-old grandson. All these things in the last few years, all of our things that we knew wiped out and gone. Man, I love the Lord. Because I'm going to be with those kids. I'm going to be with Eliana. And Obie. My point is this. We need to live and love today as if it's our last. It's very possible that somebody that's with us this morning won't be here tomorrow. And nobody knows who that is. We are clueless when these things happen. Clueless. We need to show the world God's love. By the way, we love people, gang. You know, 1 Corinthians 13, the love chapter says, abide these things, faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love. It's the example set forth by the church. Also in Thessalonica, Paul was so thankful that they had a work of faith, a labor of love, and a patience of hope. Their love got sweaty. It labored. They worked at it. It takes work, doesn't it? It takes work. America's so stinking lazy. We're so fat and abundant. When I think about the thing about, man, you have houses. Yang, when you come to the place of realizing everything you have is a gift from God, if it's good for you, then, man, you're going to arrive in a sweet spot in your life. You're going to love God. You're going to thank God. Andrew Murray writes this. Born in 1828 in South Africa, Cape Town, schooled in Scotland, did theology in Holland, and then he went home. Check this out. if you think driving back and forth to John Day is a big deal, he went and ministered in a region of 50,000 square miles. And he reached out over the Green River to, in the 1800s, there were no planes. There's no cool Land Rovers and all that stuff. He went back to that as a missionary, as a minister of the gospel of Christ. Listen to what he said. This is a guy who basically says, my life grew so much through the sufferings in my life. He said, may not a single moment, coming back to the love boat, I'm going to drop anchor in a minute. May not a single moment of my life be spent outside the light, the love, and the joy of God's presence. And not a moment without the entire surrender of myself as a vessel for him to fill full of his spirit and his love. Is that so right or what? He says, I don't want to miss a second of my life being available for God to do what he wants to do. Let's drop anchor. I want to be bold this morning with all of us. Every time I share the word, it's to us. It's not just to you. Sometimes it's only for me. It's how God operates. You know, if we live each day as if it were our last, right now, don't wait for tomorrow. Don't wait for next week. Deal with the things that need to be dealt with right now lovingly, graciously, mercifully. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. You pour out in somebody's life what they don't deserve, and it's coming back to you. You love somebody in this world that doesn't deserve it, nor did you, by the way. And guess what? You're going to experience the love of God in a greater way, in a grander way. Check it out. If we live, and here we're coming in for landing. If we live each day as if it were our last, now and instead of going skydiving, Rocky Mountain climbing, or riding 7 seconds on a bull named Fu Manchu. Who knows that song? Come on, you sinners. I'm just kidding. I like that song. Kinda. But I got no... Here's the point. What's in your bucket list? A bunch of silly, carnal, oh man, I don't want to die before I do that. Let me let you get a little insight here. Been there, did it all, still stinks. It's empty. I've taught in Israel, been to Maui. 3 days in Maui, I'm ready to come home. Why? Because I have a hard time serving God there. I'm distracted. Gang, let's live it. Fill up your bucket list with love. Love for God, love for people. We love the Lord more than any, if we love the Lord more than anything, or love our wives the way Jesus loves the bride of Christ, or raised our kids in the love and admonition of the Lord Jesus Christ, here's what do I get out of the deal anyway? Yeah, Pastor, what do I get out of the deal? What's in it for me? More stinking blessings and you'll be able to stand, that's what. Oh, let me detail those. You will experience more joy. You'll have more peace. You'll be more patient, and oh, some of you need that bad. You'll be more kind. Aren't you just drawn to kind people? How about you being that and letting the Lord draw people to your kindness? How about being gooder? Huh? I just said gooder on the World Wide Web. Awesome. Would you like to be the faithful person that God has saved you to be through the blood of His Son, Jesus Christ? I mean faithful. The one that says, man, that guy is faithful, that gal, whoo. They just need to wear a faithful hat because they're so faithful. It's who you can be, the person that is so faithful to just do and be what God wants you to do and who He wants you to be. Faithful will be your name. Gentleness will be your nature. And you will have self-control in your life. Oh, no, I ran out of pages. Would you guys come on back? I love the worship this morning. Huh? Do you guys have any idea how blessed you are? If you're out in the east in the outback, you got me. After 7,842 rounds of Lord, I lift your name on high, over 17 some years, we still need to lift His name on high, don't we? He came from heaven to earth, from the earth to the cross, to the cross, to the sky. Oh man, how awesome. Can I encourage you again this morning? Does this make any sense? Is anybody on with the love thing this morning? Is anybody lacking in this area? Come on, let's have a moment of honesty here. Who's lacking in the love thing? Get up on your feet. Come on. All of us. I don't want to leave you there alone. Make your way up. Please come and let these men minister to you. These men that God has given the blessing of overseeing this family, of serving and ministering to this family. Doesn't matter who you are, how old you are, what the need is, what's going on in your life. Doesn't have to be about you're not that loving. It can be anything. Let these men minister to you this morning. Let them put a hand upon your life and pray as the Holy Spirit moves through their hearts upon your life. Guys are going to make themselves available to you. Gang, let's not leave here the way we came this morning. If you're doing good, awesome. Do gooder. If you're not doing that well, do better. I can do all things through Christ who will strengthen me. Ask and ye shall receive. I can do all things through Christ who what? Ask and ye shall receive. All things are possible with God. What part of that don't we get? Let's be who God wants us to be. Let's surrender our lives to the Spirit of God right now, this morning. Let's worship the Lord.